Hello, my name is Stephen, and in this tutorial I'm going to give you a quick overview of Wade's camera system. Okay, firstly, to demonstrate how the camera system works, let's add a background to the scene. I've got these backgrounds that I downloaded earlier from the Clockwork Chili shop, and I'm just going to add one of these into the scene. I'm also adding a scene object with the default procedural square sprite. We'll call this object Actor, and with these two objects, we will be able to see how the camera affects everything in our scene. Now, if you move your mouse wheel over the scene editor, you can see how the camera would work. You can zoom in and out quite easily. If you click and hold your mouse wheel while moving the mouse, you can also pan the camera around in the scene. Obviously, this only affects the camera in the scene editor and not in the finished game, but the principle is exactly the same. All the objects in the scene have properties that are defined in world units. Initially, one world unit is equal to about 1 pixel. If you zoom the camera out, the world units will get smaller, which means more world units can fit on the screen, so that results in everything appearing smaller. Likewise, if we zoom in, world units become larger, so everything appears bigger. The concept of world units makes it easy to do everything independently of the screen size, so instead of thinking in pixels, you just have to think of world units. Wade will automatically stretch the available area based on your scene properties, but that is something for another tutorial. For now, we just want to focus on the camera, so we are going to make some changes to app.js. So in the init function, we are loading the scene. The load scene function is asynchronous, so this means our program does not stop while we are loading a scene. We can, however, create a callback to it, which will be executed when the scene has finished loading. So in this callback, we are going to set the camera position, and to do that, we have to provide 3 values, x, y, and z. We are going to set x and y to 0, which is the center of the screen, and z to 2. If we run the project now, everything looks smaller because we have moved the camera out. The default camera position is 0, 0, 1. Now, 0, 0, 2 means we are still focused on the center of the screen, but we have moved a bit further away. If we do the opposite and set Z to 0.5, we can see that everything is larger because we have effectively zoomed in our camera. Changing the X and Y values produces a similar effect. Moving the camera right with a positive X value, for example, would make everything in the scene appear left of where it was. Directly setting the camera position is only one way of manipulating the view and may not be suitable in all cases. As well as setting the position directly, you can also move the camera with respect to time. So, using Move Camera, let's move it from its initial position that is 001 to 002. So, we're effectively zooming out. The next parameter is the speed. We want the camera to move, so let's set the camera to move at 01 units per second, or 0.3, so it's a little bit faster. Like before, we can add a callback function to execute code once the camera's finished moving, but for now, let's just do it this way. When the game starts, you can clearly see the camera gradually zooming out. Now, instead of a constant movement, we may want a camera that changes speed as it moves. An interesting feature available to us is instead of using a speed here, we can use a function of distance to the target, which will return a speed value. This is a bit more advanced, but just for fun, let's return the distance over 2 with an initial speed of 0.2. This means that as the distance to the target decreases, the camera will slow down. Of course, you do not have to slow the camera down at a linear rate. You could speed it up Have it vary using the sine function or anything else that you want, really. Using this feature, you can create lots of interesting motions, for example, camera shakes or even cutscenes. Another thing we can do is provide the camera with a target to follow. So instead of controlling the camera directly, we can command it to follow a scene object. This could be particularly useful in a platform game where your camera is locked to your character during most of the game. So let's select our actor object and go to its onAddToScene function. We can generate a random x coordinate by using the random function. Random returns a value between 0 and 1, so if we minus 0.5 from the value it returns and times the result by a number, our range of values will be both negative and positive, with a maximum value of half the number that we have multiplied by. We will just go ahead and copy this to generate a random value for y. Then, we will make the object move to these random coordinates. So let's test this. The camera is stationary, but we should see the white actor square move to a random direction. To make this more interesting, I'm going to copy and paste this code into the object's onMoveComplete function. So once the object gets to its destination, it is going to generate a new set of coordinates and start moving again. So, if we play this now, we will see this random sequence of movements. However, we soon lose track of it because we are always looking at the same place. So this is where it gets interesting, and we tell the camera to follow the target using wade.setCameraTarget. Mousing over the function name, we see the parameters. Firstly, what is the target? So in this case, it is our actor, so we type wade.getSceneObject in brackets inside quotes actor, and let's just run it like this before we look at the additional parameters that we have here. When we run the program, we see that the camera is following the square, which means it will always be in the middle of the screen, because its initial position was also the screen center. We can also add inertia to our camera, so let's set it at 0.8. This means that the camera will take some time to catch up with the target. If we run the program, we can see the camera chasing the square. It is not quite on top of it, but it is quite close. If the square were to suddenly stop, we would see the camera keep moving, not stopping until it had caught up with the square's position. Finally, we can set a camera offset. So we are still looking at our target, but we are then offsetting the position that we're actually viewing. So in this case, let's look to the right of our target by setting our x value at 200, and we run the program, and now we see the square is to our left.